Jesus sofreu em dolor, você varia na base de varíos. Lembra-os, compraria na banta cobre de os negra. Ela nos comprará dos compre de lindos contos, compre de dinheiro, os que da barba. Oh, lombro no vos comprará dos compre de dinheiro. Oh, aleluia! Lembra-vos compre de Deus, pentela e andabara lá do sul. Bredos compraria da bato corre, e toco zuso sofrendo dos que andava. Lembra-lo dos compreendes que embralava. Thank you, Father. We give you praise. We honor you tonight, O God. We worship your holy name. Thank you because you are here to do us good. Thank you for your mighty word, the Bible, that you have given unto us, that we might know your will and your perfect plans for our lives. Lord, we come before you tonight, O God, to receive that which you have proposed to bless us with tonight. We thank you for the great mighty Holy Spirit that is in us, that is rising up on our inside to give illumination to your word, to reveal your word to us, O God, and to also help us to be doers of those words, O God. Thank you for results in our lives, in our church. Thank you, God. Blessed be your name, Lord. Thank you, Father, O God, for no weapon formed against us shall prosper. Every tongue against our spiritual growth, against the church, against the spiritual growth of this church, or numerical growth of this church, every forces of the enemy, in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ, will speak to them that is seized from their maneuvers, Lord. We thank you, God. We plead the blood of the Lord Jesus upon our lives, upon every members of this church, even for those that are not here. We plead the blood of Jesus upon them. The blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus. The blood of the new covenant. We have a new life through the blood. Lord, thank you. Blessed be your name, Lord Jesus. For in Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen and amen. And amen, amen. Hallelujah. Can you give me a little bit of volume on number 4? Just a little bit. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Okay? A little bit more? Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Okay, that's good. Hallelujah. God is good. God is good. Praise God. Down a little bit. Okay, that's fine. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you. We give you praise. We appreciate you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, brother. Good. Hallelujah. Thank God for the anointing. Everybody say, thank God for the anointing.
Thank God for the anointing.
The anointing of the Holy Spirit.
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 Praise God. Hallelujah. All right. Please, everybody, you have your Bibles, right?
Yes.
Okay, let's just lift up our Bibles to our Most High God. Now, can you turn off all other wireless receivers there, apart from mine? Turn everything off. Let them just be mine alone. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. All right. This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
The Bible is the word of God.
The word of God
is God
speaking to me now.
I have what the word says I am.
And I am
what the word says I am.
I have everything
that God has promised me in the word.
I move
by the word.
I live
by the word.
The blood of Jesus
is backing up
every word
that is written
in this Bible.
Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
All right. We've been looking at foundations for prosperity. So we're just going to continue. The last one that we spoke about, we talked about putting the word first. We also said, can you push it down a little bit? Praise God. Okay. Praise God. Hallelujah. Okay, I think that's fine. So we said putting the word first. Just a little bit up. Okay. Praise the Lord. So we said we should put the word first. We should put the word first. The Bible. Put the word of God first. So we spoke about that. Which means, it's not just in the area of prosperity alone, you know, be obedient to God's word. Because God's system is the same in every areas of our lives. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
For instance, if I say I'm obedient to God's word, but I don't love my neighbor,
Am I being obedient to his injunctions?
No.
Okay. If I say that I'm obedient to God, but I'm still harboring ill feelings, ill wills concerning my neighbor, I might be obedient to God. So because my faith is not going to work for me. Okay. Because according to Galatians, he said, faith worketh by love. Faith worketh by love, which means whatever I'm trusting God for, whatever I'm believing God for, is not going to work unless I am walking in love. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Okay? So the love of God that has been shed abroad in our hearts is mighty. And it is an essential ingredient for our faith to be able to walk. Do you understand what I'm saying? The love of God that is shed abroad in our hearts, it is an essential ingredient for our faith to walk. Because before our faith can walk, it needs that oil of love. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Because we don't want to be on the same level, right? We want to move on from glory to glory. So in order for us to move on from glory to glory, we need the knowledge of the word. We also need the knowledge of walking in love. Tell your neighbor, say walk in love.
Walk in love.
Do you guys notice something that walking in love, it is the commandments. You know, just like tithes is a commandment. It is a commandment. You know, Jesus said, a new commandment I give. A new commandment. Something new, something fresh I give unto you. That ye love one another as I have loved you. Can we comprehend the love of Christ for us? We cannot. Because it's just too much. If somebody can lay down his own life for us so that we can be back to our Heavenly Father, I don't think anybody can do that in the natural. Praise the Lord. But thank God for the love of God. Please lift up your hands and say, Lord, I thank you for your love towards me. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. You know? Yeah. By the special grace of God, after this, we're going to start a series on walking in love. Because there is no way, there's no amount of confession of God's word. There is no amount of proclaiming that we understand the promises of God, that we want the promises of God to be in our lives without walking in love. Nothing can ever work. Nothing can ever work. You know, nothing can ever work. I don't know why God is just pushing it that way. Open to 1 Corinthians 13. 1 Corinthians 13. Because I think it's important. Because we want to prosper, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So because it's part of the foundations of prosperity too. In fact, maybe one. 1 Corinthians 13. Are we all there? Chapter 13, from verse 1. Oh, hallelujah. Praise God. The love of God is shed abroad in our hearts. Please say it after me that the love of God is shed abroad
in my spirit,
not in my head.
Do you guys
notice what I said? Let's say it again. The love of God is shed abroad in my spirit. Or in my heart, not in my head. Can I explain what I mean? Which means sometimes our mind will be telling us something. Our emotions. Okay, let's say it again. The love of God is shed abroad in my heart, in my spirit, not in my emotions. Let's say it again. The love of God is shed abroad in my spirit or in my heart. Not in my emotions. You know, we said in our heart or in our mind, okay, or in our emotions. So which means sometimes, you know, thoughts could come from God, could come from the devil, could also be a product of our own reasoning. You know, if something is bothering about me, thoughts can come to our mind that, man, see what he did to me, see what she did to me, I don't think I can ever forgive her or forgive it. That could be a thought of the devil. That could also be a thought of unrenewed mind. You know what I mean? Unrenewed mind, which means a mind that hasn't fed on the word of God. You know? Because if we want results in our life, this is an area that we have to pay a very, very particular attention to. I'm always being careful about it. How many of us will see a poison, we want to put poison in our mouth?
No.
Nobody will. In his right mind, right? Nobody will. So which means, when even, think about it, every time we go to Walmart, Publix to buy something, what do we check? We check what? Expiration date. If it's expired, or 2 days or 3 days, even in our house, what do? Boom. We dump it to what? To trash.
Sometimes, why? Sometimes it's good, but we throw it
out. Sometimes it's good, right? We still throw it out, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, all right. Okay. I mean, maybe it's like 2 or 3 days past expiration date, which is still not bad, right? It's not
but
bad.
Still throw
because of the our mentality that it's bad.
You, it's bad.
It's bad?
Yeah.
Yeah. We still do it, okay? But how come we don't just say, you know, we don't just ignore it? Maybe something has been expired for like a month or 2 months. How come we don't ignore it and just eat it? Why? Because the people that have made the products, they've calculated that the best time that thing can stay fresh or stay healthy is that amount of time. So if you eat it after the expiration date, you're on your own.
Yes, exactly.
Is it not? Yeah, you're on your own because they already told you. That, come on, man, don't eat this. That this is already gone. That you cannot eat this again. Okay? So, but if you eat it after the expiration date, you are on your own. Okay? So, we are being careful.
What we eat.
We are being careful concerning what we eat, right? Yes. Why? Because we don't want it to poison us. The same way, we have to be very careful about walking in love. Why? Because we don't want it to contaminate our spiritual growth. We don't want it to contaminate our blessings, our being able to receive our blessings. We don't want it. Man, I want to be getting results every time. I don't want to get results once in a while. And one of the ways to be getting results in our areas of faith is walking in love. Please tell your neighbor that
one of the ways
of getting results
always
is walking in love.
Is
walking in love. This is not my message, but I'm just going to stay on it because I think there's something that God wants me to bring out. All right, look at verse 1. It said, though I speak with tongues of men and of angels and have not love. Now, the love here is talking about agape love, God's kinds of love. God's what? God's kind of love. You know, we have different types of love. We have the filial, erroneous, and all that. But we're talking about the agape God's kind of love. Now, the agape God's kind of love is the love that is unconditional.
Yes.
Okay. When God demonstrated his love towards us, are we worthy of his law? The Bible says when we were yet sinners, Christ did what? Died for us. When we were yet sinners. I mean, you know, sometimes when somebody have done us good, we'll be moved to repay him or her back with good, right? I said, oh man, no, okay, let's say a friend is having their daughter's wedding. You just remember that, no, I have to be at that wedding. No, why? Because I remember so time that they did this for us. Or maybe when we were having our own daughter's graduation, they flew all the way from England to, no, we have to. Did you just say that?
Yes.
But the Bible says when we were yet sinners, which means there wasn't anything that God can behold on us, that can look at us, that says, you know what? Oh, he's been good. Okay, let me send my son to die for him. No! We never deserved it. So the love of God was what? Was unconditional. It wasn't something that it is based on what we have done for him. That's why we call it grace. It is grace. You see, the love of God, the love of God in action is also grace of God in action. The love of God in action is also grace of God in action. Because we don't deserve it. We were sinners. Nothing to behold. Nothing to behold. Because for every man that has sinned, the wages of sin is what?
Death.
It's death. Because we sinned in the Garden of Eden, we were already on the path to what? To hell. Because that's not the wages. After all, if I've worked for you, if I've done like hours for you, 3 hours, 4 hours for you, 5 hours, 10 hours for you, you already told me that my wages is $10 per hour. At the end of the week, I've done 40 hours. How much should I expect before Uncle Sam takes his? No, 40 hours, $10 per hour. $400, right? Yes. Because before Uncle Sam takes his own, you know, Uncle Sam has to take his own, right? Okay? But before he takes his own, I should expect like $400, right? Okay? But at the end of the day, if you give me like $200, I'm going to ask you, how did that be? It can't be. Because that wasn't the wages, that wasn't the agreements. But according to our fall, when we fell, the wages of sin is what? Is hell. But thank God for God. Everybody say, thank God for God.
Thank God for God.
That He sent His only begotten Son for us. Okay? He died for us. So the wages of sin is death. So there wasn't anything for us to behold. Okay, look at this now. He said, though I speak with tongues of men and of angels, and have not love, or have not God's kind of love, and have not unconditional love, the love of God that is not based on how I feel. The love of God that is not based on how I feel. You know, the Bible says we walk by faith and not by sight, right? You guys know that the sight doesn't mean the same. It's talking about the senses, our human senses, which means our mind, our hearing, our perceiving, you know, our feeling and all those. We walk by faith, which means we walk by the word of God, what God has said. Even when somebody has done terrible things for us, let's just put it, we feel that somebody has done terrible things for us. Because sometimes, you know, if you don't listen to the other party, you'll think, oh man, he has done something terrible to him, or she has done something terrible to him, until you listen to both parties, you know that, oh. But at the end of the day, whatever the case may be, the love of God, it is unconditional. Praise the Lord. You see, you have to allow the love of God that is shed abroad in your heart to dominate your thinking, to dominate your emotions. Your emotions and your thinking will oftentimes not go in line with what the Word of God has said. But if you allow the love of God to dominate you, even something that's seemingly big, seemingly unsolvable in your eyes, in your presence, but when you put the love first, you will see things that seemingly unsolvable becoming solvable. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
That's why you spoke in tongues. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So which means I have to understand this. I might not feel that I love this person. I might not feel that I've forgiven this person. I might not feel that, man, I can never play with this person again. I can never do whatever with this person again. But is that what the Word of God says?
No.
Is that what it says?
No.
No. You see, forgiveness actually is for your own sake, not for the sake of that other person. You know why? Because the Bible says, faith works by love. If you want your own blessings to come to you, your own prosperity to come to you, what is it that you have to do? You have to forgive that person. The Bible says, pray. Oh my goodness. It said, pray for those who despitefully use you. Pray. Isn't that crazy? Let me put it that way. God, you are telling me that somebody that has despitefully used me, that has abused me, that has used me somehow, you are saying that I should pray for the person. You are not saying that I should pray that the person die. So pray my blessings upon that person. But in our own mind, our own imagination, what is it that our own natural mind want to do? Lord, let him die. Lord, let her die. Lord, kill him, you know. Because it's pray for them. Pray for them. Actually, let's look into that scripture. I think she probably in Matthew. If I can remember very well, is that Matthew chapter? All right, we got students of the Bible right now. Let's all look for it. I don't think it's in chapter 6. Maybe it's in chapter 7. So let's all look for it. Student of the Bible. I know it's in Matthew. Or it could be in other epistles too. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you find it, let's see. So pray for those that despitefully use you. God is good.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
If you find it, let's see. I'm looking for it too. I just want us to read that scripture. You know, this is not my sermon, but I believe that God wants me to talk about this now. Okay, I think it is a Luke. I think it's also Luke chapter 6. Okay, it's in also Luke chapter 6. Luke chapter 6. Yeah, from verse 27. Luke chapter 6. Thank God for technology. Did you guys know what I did? Just search, right, in my Bible. You see, that's one of the products of technology. Luke chapter 6, praise God for technology. Hallelujah. That is why these days, we as believers, we don't have any excuse. Do you guys understand what I'm saying? Do we have any excuse not to know the word?
No.
Thank God for those smartphones. We got Bibles downloaded on it. You can download message on it. You can keep listening to the word. Faith comes by hearing. You know, somebody says something that he said that, he said these days it seems that we are forgetting about the word. He said, how are we forgetting about the word? They say every now and then we are coming to church, we just see people with their iPad, with their iPhones and all that. I said, what? You know? He said, let's open the Bible. He said, you see them opening the Bible here. Is that the Bible? Is that the Bible? No. Come on. The Bible, he said, do you know that you can have Bible under your pillow and demon can still be battling your life?
Yeah,
why? Because the word is a letter here. But the word comes alive when it's in your spirits.
In your spirit and it's in your head.
You can yes. Hide it. You, exactly. That's how the power of the word is. So, whatever form, thank God for technology, whatever form I can get the word into my spirit, into my mind, into my spirit, I go for it. I mean, thank God. Here we can have like thousands of books, thousands of, like hundreds of Bible versions. It's just possible. Isn't that amazing that I can just make references? Okay, in those days, if you see teachers of the word, do you know what they do? They come, you know, with they have bags that they bring so many translations. Oh my goodness. I better use my hands, my strength to do something else than to be carrying Bibles and carrying all heavy. You know. So he said that the power is in the printed one. I said, No. That's not where the power lies. The power lies in the word, in your spirit, and in your mouth.
It's a book.
It's a book, right?
You know, if you don't study the word, it's...
It's nothing. It's
nothing. You know.
It's nothing.
Yeah, because it's the word that...
Yes. So I said, no. Thank God for hyper. Thank God for technology. I mean, when I was traveling to Nigeria, imagine that those ministries that I had, that I have to have a heavy two bags, 5 translations here, 10 translations here. Oh my goodness. They're going to say, what is wrong with you? Pastor, what age are you? Are you still living in the 1930s or 1940s? Come on, there's an iPad. There's a tablet. They can download all those. All you're just going to do is just put this, what's in your pocket. Boom, you go. But you know something about religion. Religion has a power to always enslave. You see, the devil knows that right now, the materials is in different forms, which means people are getting to know the materials. They are getting to understand the word. So he's also putting those thoughts in those minds of those people that, you know what? No, it's just the Bible. It's just that paper. That's where the power is. No. The power lies when you study the word, you meditate on the word, and you speak the word. That becomes it becomes some life. Jesus said, the word I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. No, I don't play with religion. I don't play traditions. I play the word of God. I deal with the word of God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
All right, that's just by the way. I believe that it's blessed someone.
Amen.
All right, look at verse 27. It said, but I say to you, hear. And I say to you who hear, love what? Love what? Love what? Your enemies. After all, my wife is not my enemy. you understand what I'm saying? I'm just saying, let's not even say that she is, but the Bible is saying what? Love her. And after all, I'm not her enemy. Let's even assume that I am. The Bible says what? She should love me. After all, my kids are not my enemies. But if they are, the Bible says what? Love them. After all, I'm not their enemy. But if I am, the Bible says they should what? They should love me. I'm just showing you that the extents. Do you understand what I'm saying? The extents. Because in this church, we believe in the power of God's word, the integrity of God's word. We believe in the power of love. Because we want to be getting results. So if we don't talk to ourselves that we're going to walk in love, then there is no way our faith is going to work for us. No way. See that? The scripture says, love your enemies. And do good. Oh, Lord Jesus, are you for real? Mm-hmm. He said, love your enemies and do good to those who hate you. What? You want me to do good to them? You mean if I feel that this person doesn't like me, you want me to do good to them? Oh, Lord Jesus, you must be kidding me. No, he's not kidding. He's for real. He's serious about it. He's for real. He's serious about it. I thank God for the Holy Ghost. I think God is as set to move us into a new level. He's getting us ready. Remember, I was going to teach about the foundations, but this is part of the foundation of prosperity. Because if we are trusting God for a financial breakthrough, if we are not walking in love, will our financial breakthrough ever come? No way. Remember the first part that we talked about, we said, put the word of God first. So which means when I feel that this person hates me, this person doesn't like my God, as some would put it, but God says I should put his word first. What does his word say? Love him. Do good to him. Do good to him. Look at verse 28. He said, bless those who curse you. Jesus again. I should bless. Did they say, if they say my mama, did they say I should say their mama too? No. If they say help me, do they say I should help them too? No. If they say, if they tell me that I'm SOB, should I say they're SOB too? No. What does the word say? What does the word say that I should do?
Bless them.
I should pray or bless them. Which means when they are telling me that I'm SOB, somebody is wondering what a SOB is. I'm saying them, he's thinking right. He's thinking that what is. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Don't worry. It's a bad word. Just doesn't understand it that way. Okay? It's a bless those who curse you. Which means when somebody crosses me, when somebody says something bad about me, okay? It's really curses it about me. The word says I should do what? Bless. I should bless. Okay, look at this. And pray for those who spitefully. Pray for those who spitefully. Now, that word spiteful, it means showing or caused by malice. Showing or caused by malice. Which means when you don't respect somebody, the person or person, you don't respect that person. You're looking down at that person. You don't appreciate the person. spitefully. You are spiting the person. That's what it means. But what does the word say? The word says what? I should pray for those who spitefully use me. Okay, the question is, would there be such people in our lives that they want to spitefully use us? Which means they're not appreciating us, but they're just looking for what they can get from us and use us and do what? And dump us. Would there be such people in our lives? Yes.
All the time.
All the time. Good to come across them. But what does the word say? It said, pray for them. You see, in as much that we're still in this tabernacle, in this flesh, for those that are not born again, even for those that are born again, that their mind has not been renewed by the word of God, that they are allowing their mind, their unrenewed mind, and their flesh to dominate them, the works of the flesh to dominate them, they're still going to behave as if they are not even born again believers. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
They're still going to behave that. Okay, even to the unbelievers that they are not born again, they're going to do what? They're going to spitefully use us. Which means they're not going to appreciate us. All they're just looking for is to get something from us. Get something from us, that's it. But what does the word say?
Still
huh? We should pray for them. Pray for them. Look at verse 29. Is that so? Now, please, am I the one who is saying all this? Am I?
No.
Who is saying this?
Jesus.
Okay, look at verse 29. Is that to him who strikes you on the one cheek, offer the other also? Now, we need to understand this. That it's not saying that if somebody comes to you and just bump, slaps you the one, then you say, okay, all right, you want the other, then the other one? No. Okay? But it's just saying that you don't retaliate. You understand? You don't render evil for evil. Okay? You don't render evil for evil. Okay. He said, and from you who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. It's amazing that Jesus, are you telling us that we should just be like a dummy right now? No. We need to understand the love of God. Love takes times. Love takes times. When we score, remember the word of God is for rebuke, for correction, for admonition. God can rebuke us. God can rebuke us, can correct us. Okay? So the love of God, I mean, I can hear the Spirit of God saying that when you allow the love of God that is shed abroad in your hearts to permeate through you, you will begin to see yourself on a new level of life. That's what the Spirit of God just said right now. When you allow the love of God to permeate through you, you begin to see yourself on a new level of life. How many of us want to see ourselves? I want to see myself on a new level of life, which means my story changed, which means what they have thought about me has changed. Why? Because the love that I'm the love of God that is shared abroad in my heart, I'm allowing it to come out. It doesn't matter what that person has done to you. In fact, the Spirit of God is saying that somebody needs to let go of someone that is holding, still holding the person. You know, sometimes we say we forgive. But anytime we're talking about that, what that person has done to us, you can see the passion. You know, you can see the passion that's, Mary did that, she did that. Oh, just a man of God said something. He said, a man, Kenneth Egan, he said somebody came to him. He said, you know, Brother Egan, I need you to pray for me to be able to, I need you to pray for me. He said, I've forgiven that person, but I just want you to pray for me. He said, I can never remember what that old bastard did. Oh, what? No, I forgive that person. Does this show that the person has forgiven that person?
No.
He said, I can never remember what that old bastard, excuse my language, did for me. He said, sister, he said, you haven't forgiven that person. He said, what? Yeah, you haven't. You're still holding the person. You need to let go. Hallelujah.
I think it's like, you can forgive, but you can't forget.
You can forgive, but the word of God asks us to what? To forget.
It is hard to forget, but...
It could be hard to forget,
but you have to.
Okay, the question is, does it mean that the thoughts will not flash through our mind? It will.
It will.
But in our hearts, we are forgiven. When those thoughts are coming, we should not entertain, we should not take those thoughts. Because that's what the word says. We should forgive and forget. Forgive and forget. Forgetting might not be easy, but that's the law. You know, because the mind might still be thinking, oh, he did me wrong, she did me wrong, she did this. Oh, no, Lord. You know, sometimes you have to talk to yourself. You know, action that's no, I've forgiven this person, Lord. And I forgive this person now, and I forget about it. I'm forgetting about it. I forget about it. Devil, you can't bring it to my mind again. No way, you can't. Because God says I should forgive and forget. All right, the question is, things that we have done in our old life, does God have a remembrance of it?
No.
He said, I, in Isaiah, am he that have forgiven your trespasses and blot out your transgressions. Your iniquities will I remember no more. Ephesians 5, verse 1, said, be ye therefore what? Imitators of God. And what? And walk in love. If you see somebody is imitating someone, which means you are following the footsteps, you are seeing what he or she is doing, you are doing exactly the same thing. You know, our goal is to be like Jesus in behavior, in actions, and everything, because he's our great leader, he's our great example. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Look at verse. So if he has for cloak, I should also not, you know, you want some cloak? Okay. Maybe somebody comes to borrow some suit jacket. Are you sure you got some tie or some shirt that you can wear? I got everything. Here you go. Which means we should be willing. We should give liberally. Okay? Even to that person that has caused us. Even to that person that has done us evil. Why? Because I just want my blessing to come. I don't want anything to hold my blessing down. Let me put it this way. I don't want anything to hold my money down. My financial blessing down. Do you want anything to hold your financial blessing down?
No.
Poverty is evil. So whatever that I need to do to give me my financial breakthrough, I am ready for it, because I don't want to be thinking every time, oh, I got to spend this. I'm thinking, okay, do I have this? Do I have the money? No. God has said to move us to the realm of abundance. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I think I'm still going to continue with this, you know, because it's very important. Because, of course, thank God we are teaching about the prosperity principles on Thursday, but the law is very important. Very, very important. Look at verse 30. It says, give to everyone who ask of you, and from him who takes away your goods, do not ask them back. You know, on campus in those days, we have friends, they will come to you, hey, please, do you have $10 there? Borrow it from me, I'll give it back to you.
After.
I don't know if they've ever returned it, such. You know what I'm saying? Or somebody will just come, hey, please, I don't have anything to eat. Can you borrow me some curry or some rice? You know, just give some a little small cups. When I get my own rice, I'll return it to you back. You know what I'm saying?
He will see you, he will talk to you nice, and then pretend like he forgot you. He don't remember that he took something from you.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So, funny, right? Yes, it happens. Even in real life, you know, in real life, somebody will come. I remember a particular time that a brother called me. He said, please, I need this. And here's something that my wife and we've made up our mind. Okay? Borrow people money? No. But whatever we can give,
help.
You know, because we see it as an opportunity also to do good. So the brother said everything. I said, brother, this amount that you're asking, I don't have it, but this is how much I can give you. You know, I think he was asking for like maybe $500. I said, I don't have, you know, but I said, I can loan you some, like, I mean, give you some 200 or so. You know, maybe I can't remember the exact figure. He said, really? I said, please, you're not paying back. This is a gift to you. This is to you. I remember another person, called my wife. He said, can you borrow me this? I said, no. You know, I said, but this is $100. You know, I said, this is for you. Please, do not think about paying back. No, this is God. This is God giving God's gifts to you. You know, because, I mean, there are people that they are sincere in their hearts that they remember they got it from you, but they still don't have the means. So they're not under pressure. When they see you, they don't feel comfortable. They'll be thinking, man, oh, you know, they'll be feeling bad, but it's not their fault. They don't have it then.
What do you say? Oh, I didn't forget it.
Yeah.
I remember.
It's even good if they even tell you that I didn't forget. It's even good, which means they remember.
But they always have pressure anytime they meet you.
Yes, exactly. The pressure, yes.
Pressure, you know. So it's sometimes when you're coming, instead of you see them passing,
they will go the other way.
But you know, I always do that.
Yeah.
I keep them, don't even think about it.
Yeah.
But when they see you, they feel bad.
Man, that's a man among you. Yeah.
You know.
I'm telling you. Yeah. So because she was surprised. I said, no. I said, this is a gift, please. Understand it. Okay? Because, I mean, it's not their fault, but they really want so, but they don't just have the means. He said in verse 31, they say, and just as you want men to do to you, oh, do also to them what?
Likewise.
Do also to those likewise. Which means, if I want, you say, scripture says, whoever shows himself friendly will also have friends. Yes. If every point in time, I'm always snap. There is no way that I can ever have friends. Why? Because what am I doing? I'm pushing them away. Huh? I'm chasing people away. I'm pushing them away. Okay? So which means, if I really want to have friends, what is it that I should do? I should what? I should be friendly. He said, whatsoever a man soweth, he reaps. He says, sowing, every part of our lives is about sowing, it's about giving, not just finance. If I don't do good to you, I shouldn't expect good back. It's a seed. So if I want friends, I should show myself friendly. It's a seed. I should not be snapping at my sister, or snapping at my brother, snapping at my wife, or my wife snapping at me. Because in the realm, she's gonna push me away. Or anytime I'm talking to my daughter, my daughter is snapping at me. Of course, you know, as a father, I'm come on, stop that. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. All right, look at verse 32. He said, but if you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For evil sinners love those who love them. Evil sinners, they love those who love them. You know, that's how sinners do, right?
Yeah.
You know, there are people on campus, man. You know, my friends on campus. You know, they said they have a book. You know, they put names. He did me, man, they're striking out. He's no longer my friend. You know, we see those things amongst their kids, right? Is that what happened? He did this to me. He's no longer my friend. She's no longer my friend. That's why God doesn't want us to remain as a babe. He wants us to grow up spiritually. Okay? He said, well, he did that to me. He did that to me. No, he's no longer my friend. Strike his name out. What? Yeah, he did that to me. No, mama, no, he's no longer my friend. I'm not going to play with him again. And on campus, see them, they write it down. They say, oh, no, I don't play with him again. Or they say, well, I don't like him again. Okay, look at this. Verse 33. And if you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that? He said the love of God is what is unconditional. It's not based on if you do good to me. Okay? For evil sinners do the same. And if you lend to those from whom you hope to receive back, what credit is that to you? For evil sinners lend to sinners to receive as much back. You guys know that. You guys know an example of this. The credit card company. And they give you 200, they give you 29% interest rate, but I know.
Yes.
He's like, what? Because that's what that's how they believe that they're making their own money.
Yeah.
That's what they do. That's their own method of doing something. Okay? Verse 35 says, but love your enemies, do good and lend, hoping for nothing in return. Hoping for nothing in return. And your reward will be what? Will be what?
Great.
Great. And your reward will be great. And you will be the sons of the Most High. How many of us wants to be an imitator of God? Imitating God. Do you all see what God's law will do? And you'll be the sons of the Most High. For he is kind to the unthankful and evil. How many of us believe that God is still kind even to unbelievers today?
Yes.
Rain still come down. When they plant, they still sow, right?
Yes.
The world hasn't been destroyed. He's still kind to them. He's still sending men out to preach the gospel into the mission fields, right?
Yeah.
To preach the gospel. That's being kind to them, right?
Yeah.
Because he wants them to hear the gospel, the good news. Do you all know that the sinners, the wages of their sins have been paid for by Christ?
Yeah.
He's being still kind. He said, verse 36, therefore be merciful, just as your Father also is merciful. 1 Corinthians 13, he said, if I speak the tongues of angels, do all those, he even went further than if I can give my body to be bound, have not love, what did he say? It's vain. It's vain. So which means everything we do should be motivated by love. Our giving to the work of God should be motivated by love. Our tithing should be motivated by love. Of course, there's blessing that will come upon it. Remember, he said there will be a great reward for us. But we got to put the love of God first. We have to put the love of God first. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Father, we thank you. We give you praise. We worship your holy name for tonight. We appreciate you for the power that is in your word, Lord. Because your word says they will know you.